Hi there, BCI singers and choral music friends. I'm Steve Smith, president of Berkshire Choral International. Everyone here at BCI hopes that you're well and taking good care of yourself during this challenging time. As we stay home, working to flatten the curve of COVID-19, I know that we're all missing our choral communities and the opportunity to sing together. BCI has always been a place for people who love to sing. So over the coming weeks, we're going to work to put together some opportunities that can help us stay in touch with one another and share our passion for great choral music. We'll keep you updated by email and Facebook. So if you go to berkshirechoral.org, there are links there where you can sign up for both our email and Facebook should you need those links. Nothing can replace the feeling of singing with each other in person, but singing in choruses does help us become resilient and caring. I hope that you enjoy this listening party, and now let me hand it over to our music director, Frank Nemhauser. Thanks so much. So welcome to our BCI Friends and Singers. We're glad you could join us today. I'm Steve Smith, president of Berkshire Choral International, and I'm joined by my colleague, Frank Nemhauser, who's our music director. Frank, how are you doing today?
I'm doing pretty well. Thank you very much.
Great. So as we get used to living in this COVID-19 world that we're living in, we here at BCI are working on some ideas of just things that we can do to keep us connected both as friends and singers and as people who share their passion for choral music. So today's a little experiment. We're going to put together a listening party. The first program that we were going to do this summer before it got canceled was Mozart's Requiem. So Frank, you have queued up a couple of different recordings of the Mozart Requiem for us to listen to today. What do we have on tap?
I thought it would be interesting to compare two performances of the Mozart Requiem, one from 40 or 50 years ago, conducted by von Karajan, and one more modern recording conducted by Felipe Hervega, because I think there are pretty interesting and obvious differences that we can talk about.
Great. So from your experience, how has historically informed performance influenced how large choruses perform some of these classic works?
Well, I think it has changed a lot. I think starting with the historical performance movement, one saw smaller groups of singers performing. You know, it used to be that Messiah was performed by large choruses all the time. And then we started getting smaller groups where there were perhaps 30 people in the orchestra and 30 people in the chorus. And the same with Mozart Requiem. And I think today, even among larger choruses, the idea of articulation has changed, of terrace dynamics, articulation in the orchestra and having the chorus match that articulation, even among larger groups. So the ideas, I think, are very different now than they were in von Karajan's day.
Right. So I'm new to BCI and its traditions, but I was looking back on our website to look at our past performances of the Mozart Requiem. So I've noted you've conducted it twice, so I'm going to assume that you're a good expert here. And I see performances, I think, going back, I'm checking my notes here, as early as like 1984 with Joe Flummerfelt. Mm-hmm. What have you observed? What are some of the differences you've observed just in BCI's performances?
I have to say that the 1984 performance was even before my BCI time. It's also interesting just to see different conductors' interpretation. Whether or not they're talking about historically performed performances, their idea of interpretation having to do with tempo, text interpretation, where is the drama in the piece? And it's fascinating to me to see the different conductors and their interpretation. This is one of the great benefits that BCI has had on my life, and that is watching all of these wonderful conductors work and learning from them and seeing their different interpretations as well.
So that's an interesting point. And so I'm thinking in my own listening to historically informed performances, and I'm not going to name any names, but in the 80s and 90s, some of the performances I heard struck me to be more about technique and performance practice, and I felt like I missed the interpretive part. So, you know, I've previewed the things we're going to listen to today, and certainly Von Karajan is magisterial and it brings all the emotion you can would expect, but so does the Herwegia performance. But in your experience, sort of where does technique leave off and interpretation come in?
Well, I once had a piano teacher who told me, I don't care how deeply you feel the slow movement of a Beethoven sonata if you can't trill. Right? So, but you have to have the technique, but the technique has to serve the emotion. That's the way I look at it. You have to have the technique to do what you want to do musically and emotionally. So one of my fondest memories of Mozart Requiem, I prepared the Baltimore Symphony chorus. This goes back maybe 20 years. And I prepared the, as in many symphony choruses, you have someone working with a chorus to prepare them for the conductor. So I prepared the chorus and we did a lot of more modern articulation, terrace dynamics, you know, shortening ends of phrases, shortening notes here and there, articulating. And then the conductor came in, who was a very sort of old world European conductor. And it was, you know, 18 first violins all playing full bow. And it was very much not the interpretation that I had. And there was an ad for Oldsmobile at the time. Oldsmobile was trying to get people to not think of their cars as their father's car. So right. This is not your father's Oldsmobile. And after the first rehearsal and the chorus and I, we were all in shock. And I said to the chorus, this is your father's Oldsmobile and it is a big luxury car and enjoy the ride. And that's what we did. There is a lot to be said for the beauty and the passion of some of these older recordings, even though we may not think of the phrasing in the same way today. There's a lot of beauty and the commitment is certainly there.
Right, and in listening to these two recordings, I mean, immediately with the Von Karajan, I got that legato phrasing and everything connected. And then it's hard to be shocked by the Mozart Requiem, but then when I transitioned to the other, the space between phrases, the silence in between the notes, that was really kind of a shock after coming off this, you know, 80s or 90s recording.
Exactly. And perhaps the simplest way to think about it, if you think about the sound, the difference in sound between a note struck on a harpsichord and a note played on a piano, the sound of the harpsichord dies out much faster. The piano sustains much longer. So that's an analogy one can use for the instruments of the time and the sound dying out, and therefore the vocal sounds. We try to match the vocal sound to the sound of the earlier instruments. And that's a big part of the difference in articulation.
So, you know, my college training was as an instrumentalist, as a trombonist. And because of the way the Von Karajan recording was recorded, there's sort of this set camera on this, you know, suite of trombones, big modern trombones. And I mean, I love that big Berner sound. Then you listen to the early instruments and it's such a, you know, narrower and punchy sound. Tell me a little bit sort of your experience. What's the difference in singing between sort of traditional instruments? How do you balance the choral sound with sort of full traditional orchestra and early instruments or smaller forces?
Well, I think good singing is good singing. And I don't want to inhibit singers, especially in the world of volunteer choruses where, in all honesty, not a lot of people have had ongoing vocal training where they have the technique to perhaps modify their sound. So good singing is good singing, but if you listen to what's happening in the other parts and also can listen to the orchestra parts so that you can match what you're doing to the orchestra sound. For me, I have never liked the word blend. I like the word listen. And if you listen to what's around you, it does a pretty good job of accomplishing what you want to accomplish. as far as getting the kind of sound. And then some of it is the technique. Yes, we're going to shorten this note. We're going to come away from this phrase, decrescendo here, that sort of thing.
Is there anything else that you'd like us to listen for in these performances?
Well, a couple of things. I think the tempi are very different. If you listen to the whole recording, I don't remember exactly, but it's almost 10 minutes longer, the von Karajan recording, than the Herrevega. That's pretty significant, right? Also, intonation, pitch. You know, we pretty much tune to a standard A440 intonation these days. Now, Europe may tune a little higher, they may tune a little lower in some place, but the idea was, quote-unquote, Baroque tuning was A415, which is about a half step lower than what we're used to today. A few years ago, when BCI was in Vienna and Jane Glover conducted a concert of Haydn and Schubert, they tune it 430 for the classical period. So that was very interesting. It created a very warm sound.
Mm-hmm.
So listen for the difference in the pitch, the intonation, as well as the tempi. What about the soloist? Do you like the style of the soloist singing? Do you prefer one over the other? What about the size of the orchestra? I don't know whether you can tell, but there, from some shots, you can tell that the size of the chorus and the orchestra in the von Karajan recording is much larger than in the Herrevega. What do you think about that? What kind of sound does that produce? So those are the things I would listen for.
Great. So Frank, as we're listening along, I think if we do this right, people will be able to use the comment feature on YouTube to ask you questions in real time as we're listening. So I just wanna be sure that folks know that that's there and you'll be responding.
Sure, absolutely.
What questions should we not ask you?
Who's your favorite conductor? Who's your favorite singer? I really don't have one. I'm completely fickle in these areas. It varies from day to day and hour to hour.
Great. Well, Frank, thanks for taking time to do this with us, and we hope that you all enjoy listening along. And if you're listening live with us, looking forward to your comments.
Right-ho. Enjoy.
Creatura, passion.